My name is Carney Thompson, and I'm an invertebrate paleontologist, which means that I study shells that died a long time ago. This part of the museum is different from our public-facing side, which some of you may be familiar with. And welcome to the Invertebrate Paleontology Collection.
The invertebrate fossils that we find come in all different forms. Sometimes we have body fossils, sometimes they're silicified, sometimes they're molded. And so what I'm doing is we've taken the moldic fossils and we pour an RTV silicone rubber into the void. Once it sets up, we can peel it out and see what the fossil looked like. So here you can see a semicassis. Once we have these positives, we can identify them much, much easier. Well, currently we have about 7 million specimens from around the world. The collection is primarily 65 million years old or younger. Primarily our interest and the research that we do here is the last 65 million years. About 75% of the specimens in those collections are mollusks. So the type collection, the most important specimens in our collection. Holotype is the specimen on which a new species is based. Stratigraphic collections are used by folks that are interested in knowing the superposition of the shells. The teaching collections for teaching classes. One such class was ancient environments, also invertebrate paleontology. We also send out quite a bit of material to other museums for their education program. We have lots of research questions that we're asking, predations, diversity, and so we're constantly providing specimens and information to researchers around the world. I actually got to start collecting fossils when I was a youngster in Okinawa, Japan, and I started collecting and haven't stopped. But we do a lot of field work. Currently, we're working sites in Cuba, the Bahamas, Antigua, Jamaica, Dominican Republic. So that's where our primary focus is. Last year, we focused quite heavily on Po Plain of Italy and some other localities in Europe. Cataloging process is basically after we've prepared and organized the fossil material, it needs to be cataloged with registration numbers put on it, entered into a database and numbered. I'll open up specimens of Scaffeller, the volute, and especially Genonia. We have lots of them from the fossil record, too, here in Florida. We have quite an extensive collection of this particular species, Scaffella floridana. Even as fossils, they still have their color pattern. Why don't we go and take a look at some of the larger specimens that we have on shelving units in the next aisle over.
Wow, it's been great to see all these different kinds of shells. But this one looks pretty chewed up. It has a lot of holes in it. Why does this happen?
After these animals die, their skeletal remains are on the bottom of the ocean, and they get growths on them like sponges. And this one, all these holes are caused by sulfur sponges. And so those sulfur sponges dissolve the calcium carbonate on the shell. Another shell, speaking of predation, are these chasis shells, also called helmet shells. The interesting thing about chasid shells is they primarily predate or bore into sea urchins and sea biscuits and sand dollars. And here at the Florida Museum of Natural History, we have several people that are studying predation by helmet shells on echinoids through time. These are actually snails. These are marine snails of the family Turritellidae. The genus is called Vermicularia. Mm. And these are from the Pliocene, from shell pits down in Sarasota and Manatee County. What's really interesting about these are that these are a colonial type of habit for these gastropods. And that's something that you don't see very often in the modern or the fossil record. You probably won't see these large segments like this coiled. But you might find smaller pieces. You probably find them on the beaches around Florida. But we don't see these big structures like we did in the Pliocene and Pleistocene, where they stretch for hundreds of yards. Carmi, I know this is one of your favorite shells. These are Aturia alabamensis, and they actually don't have a shell left. You're looking at the internal and external molds.
Now, cephalopods, if you think about them living today, are mostly seen as squids and octopods, but these are closest in relation to the nautilus, and some of you may collect nautilus shells.
But cephalopods are a little less common in general in the fossil record. Right now, we're looking at some of the chambers of that animal. And those chambers are where, using a very small tube, they can regulate the position of their body in the water column when they were alive. Some of these specimens are from here in Florida, but we can also find them around other places like Georgia and Alabama. And that is an example of the tube that allows different amounts of water and air to enter the chambers and allows the animal to move through the water column.
And these Acheuria lived here in Florida about 35 to 40 million years ago. So these are truly ancient cephalopods.
We'd like to thank all of you at the Sanibel Captiva Shell Club for coming along with us on this virtual collection tour today.